this lecture is about fractures in children. Ana Sara Asiri, and I'm going to explain the most common fractures in children. Just a quick disclaimer, this lecture is not inclusive of all fractures in children. It just includes the most common and also includes the ones that are included in our curriculum in sixth year Taif University 2020. The first thing I'm going to talk about is children bones. What's the difference between a children bone and an adult bone? The first thing is elasticity. Children bones are more elastic, and that's because they contain a lot of collagen. That's going to lead to specific types of fracture like buccal fracture and green stick fractures. The second thing children bone have is remodeling. What are the things that promote remodeling? The thick preosteum around the bone, which is a thick connective tissue that helps in the remodeling and a fast healing. The second thing, if a child has a 2 year or more of growth potential, he's going to have a higher remodeling rate. The third thing is that fractures that are near the physis or the growth plates are going to have a higher remodeling rate. Other factors that hinders the remodeling is like an older child who has a fracture, he's going to have a lesser remodeling rate than a child who's younger. The second thing is a mid shaft fracture. The far you get from the growth plate, the less remodeling you're going to get. Large angulation, 20 to 30 degree or more. So if the bone has a large angle after the fracture, there will be less remodeling. Also rotational deformities and interarticular deformities. The fourth thing is that children bones are weaker than the ligaments, which means there will be less strains and more fractures. The most common site for fractures is in the metaphysis, and the most important place to have a fracture in children is the physis or the growth plate fractures, because that can lead to a growth limitation or a growth arrest, which happens when the physial barb forms. Physial barb is basically a bony formation in the growth plate. There is two types of growth arrest. We have a complete arrest, which leads to a discrepancy between the two legs, and the partial arrest, which leads to angulation and abnormal angles in the bone. So you're going to think logically, we need to cut this bone, this bony bar, so that the leg can continue growing and expanding in length. But there is specific indications. The first thing, if the child has more than 2 years of remaining growth, or if their physical involvement is less than 50%. So if there is less than 50% bony bar, then we're going to do a bar resection. So what are you going to do if a child is older and he doesn't have a 2 years of remaining growth? So you're basically going to stop or you're going to do a surgical arrest of the growth in the same injured bone, and you're going to also do an arrest in the other leg so that you don't have a leg length discrepancy. It's really important to know the types of physis fractures, which is called the Salter-Harris classification. Salter-Harris classifications are five types of fractures. The first type is physial separation. You are just going to separate the growth plate. The second type is physial and metaphysis fracture. So the fractures go through the metaphysis and go through the growth plate. The third type is the physial and epiphysis fracture. The fourth type is a physial and metaphysis and an epiphysis fracture. The fifth type is a crush in the growth plate. Why it's important to know this classification? Because management depends basically on this classification. So in type 1 and in type 2, you're going to do a closed reduction and immobilization. In type 3, 4, and 5, you need to do an open reduction and internal fixation. Let's go to the first type of fractures, the green stick fracture. It has three types. The first type, it's called a transverse fracture. The second type is a torus or a buckling fracture. The third type is bowing fracture. So the transverse fracture, the bone bends and it partially breaks, but it does not break all the way. So the fracture that extends to the midpoint of the bone and without any disturbance in the opposite cortex. So as you can see, there is a fracture that does not go all the way. There is still intact cortex in the other side. The second type is the buccal or the torus fracture. This is an impaction to the bone that caused a swelling or a protrusion in the bone. The third type is bowing fracture. The bowing fracture basically is not disturbance in the continuity of the bone. Rather, it's a curve that formed in the longitudinal axis of the bone. So as you can see, there is a bend in the longitudinal axis of the bone without a disturbance in the continuity of the bone. So these three types of green stick fractures are due to the high elasticity in children. Both bone forearm fractures is usually associated with other conditions like nerve injuries, most commonly the median nerve. And the second thing is floating elbow. If it happens with an ipsilateral supracondylar fractures, and we're going to discuss the supracondylar fractures in details. If you order an anteroposterior and a lateral forearm x-ray, look for fractures either in both the radius and the ulna, or just look for a fracture in one bone and a blastic deformation of the bone, and do not miss if the patient has a blastic deformation of both bones. How do you manage this patient, either non-operatively or operatively? Non-operatively, you're just going to do close reduction and immobilization, and operatively, you have to do an open reduction and internal fixation. In the close reduction and immobilization, reserve it to patients with green stick injuries and blastic deformations, while the patients who have open fractures or refractures or unacceptable alignment following close reduction is a green. This picture is a green stick fracture of the ulna and a plastic deformation of the radius. Possible complications are refractures, malunion, and compartment syndrome and synostosis. Synostosis is basically an abnormal fusion between the two bones, for example, the radius and the ulna. It's really important to know how to read an elbow x-ray. For example, this view is a lateral view of the elbow. In the lateral view of the elbow, look first of all for an hourglass appearance like this one. You can see clearly here that there is an hourglass or figure of eight appearance. And the importance of this hourglass or figure of eight appearance is that you want to make sure that the anterohumeral line is right. If you do not see it, you cannot draw an accurate anterohumeral line. Also, another important line is the radiocapitellar line. And both of these lines should intersect with the capitellum in the middle point of the capitellum. If you see that this capitellum is not intersecting with the anterohumeral line or the radiocapitellar line, you need to suspect a specific fracture. Also, you have to assess the bone. Look at the head of the radius, look at the distal humerus, look at the capitellum, look at the olecranon, and look at the ulna as well. The last thing you need to know is the ossification center. Ossification centers can be memorized in the mnemonic CRITO: capitulum, radial head, medial epicondyle, trochlea, olecranon, and lateral epicondyle. Each one of them has a specific year of ossification and a specific year of fusion. And you might think, what's the importance of knowing the ossification center's specific age of ossification and fusion? And that's because you do not want to misdiagnose them as fractures when they are actually ossification centers. You need to know how to read a normal elbow x-ray before assessing an elbow fracture. The first type, it's the most common, which is the supracondylar fracture. It has two types, an extension type and affliction type. And these two types depend on the mechanism of injury. In the extension type, which is the most common, you're going to have the distal fragment displaced posteriorly. So let's say that this is an extension type and this is the distal part. The distal part is going to go posteriorly. And we have two types of posterior displacement, either a posteromedial displacement or a posterolateral displacement. And it's important to know that the posteromedial displacement is more susceptible to injure the radial nerve, while the posterolateral displacement is more susceptible to injure the median and the brachial arch. It's also important to know that the most common nerve injury in the extension type is the anterior interosseous nerve. And we're going to see how to examine a patient with a possible anterior interosseous nerve injury. Also, you need to know that the percutaneous pinning insertion should be while the elbow is flexed in the extension type. The other type, which is the flexion, which is less common, is the flexion type. And the distal fragment is usually displaced anteriorly. And it happened due to a falling on the olecranon. And the most common type of nerve injury is the ulnar injury. Pins should be inserted when the elbow is extended. The most important thing to know about the supracondylar fracture is the Gartland classification. Gartland classification can happen with either the flexion or the extension type. Type 1 Gartland classification is non-displacement type. So there is a fracture, but there is no displacement at all. And we're going to fix this type of fracture by cast and immobilization. The second type is displaced, but only on a sagittal plane, and we can fix it by close reduction and percutaneous pinning. The third type is displaced in more than one plane, and we can fix it by closed reduction and percutaneous pinning and open reduction if it's needed. The fourth type is a complete preosteal disruption, as you can see. The red line resembles the preosteum. Here we can see a complete preosteal disruption, and we can fix it by closed reduction and percutaneous pinning or open reduction if it's needed. How to assess the neurobrachia or the nerve injury? The first one is the anterior interosseous nerve, which is a branch from the median nerve. It's the most common nerve palsy, and you can assess it by asking the patient to do this sign. If the patient cannot do the OK sign, you're going to suspect an anterior interosseous nerve injury. The second most common type is the radial nerve palsy. If they cannot extend it and there is a wrist drop, think of radial nerve palsy. Ulnar nerve palsy usually affect the sensation part as colored in the yellow color. The second thing is the vascular compromise. It's really important to assess the pulse and the perfusion. The pulse is assessed by palpation and biphasic Doppler pulse. The most common injured artery is the brachial artery. Assess the vascular perfusion by looking at the hand. Is it cold? Is it pale? Is the artery capillary refilled more than 2 seconds? And usually if there is no adequate perfusion after the reduction, we need to do vascular exploration. If you do an elbow x-ray, what are you going to look for if you are suspecting a supracondylar fraction? The first thing is called the sail sign, which is the anterior fat pad sign. If you see here a sail sign anteriorly or posteriorly, think of oculate fracture and a developing hematoma. The second thing you're going to look at is the displacement of the anterior humeral line. The anterior humeral line should intersect the middle third of the capitulum. If it does not intersect the middle third of the capitulum, for example, in this picture, this line should be in the middle of the capitulum. This is displaced posteriorly, and you're going to see the posterior displacement in the extension type and the anterior displacement in the flexion type. Also assess if there is any alteration of the Bowman angle. Supracondylar fractures can be managed operatively or non-operatively. Non-operatively is a long arm casting with less than 90 degree elbow flexion. We do the non-operative management if the patient hand is well perfused without neurodeficit or in type 1 non-displaced fractures. The operative management are composed of three types: a closed reduction with percutaneous pinning, emergent vascular exploration and closed reduction percutaneous pinning, or open reduction percutaneous pinning with or without vascular exploration. The first one is the closed reduction and percutaneous pinning. We do it for type 2 and type 3 supracondylar fractures, and also in the flexion type. But we do it depending on the urgency of this procedure. We have non-urgent, urgent, and emergent. The non-urgent, it can wait the next day or it can wait overnight. And we can let the patient wait if the hand is well perfused and there is no neurodeficit. Urgent in the same day, and it cannot wait if the hand is pulseless but it's well perfused, or if there is a sensory nerve deficit, or if there is excessive swelling, or if there is brachialis sign. Brachialis sign is basically a comosis or dimpling, or if there is a bulbable subcutaneous bone fragments. Floating elbow, if there is a forearm or wrist fractures at the same time, and it's important to fix it at the same day to decrease the risk of compartment syndrome. Emergent within few hours, if there is a poorly perfused hand, we need to do emergent closed reduction and percutaneous pinning. Always remember to check the vascular status after the reduction. So you did your reduction, you need to assess the pulse and the perfusion again. If the hand is not well perfused, you need to do vascular exploration. And we do the open reduction and percutaneous pinning with or without vascular exploration for patients who have open fractures, failed closed reduction. Two types of pinning: cross pinning or parallel and divergent pinning. Complications of supracondylar fractures are pin migration, infection, cuberous valgus, cuberous varus, recurvatum, Volkmann ischemic contractures, postoperative stiffness, vascular injuries in the brachial artery, compartment syndrome, especially if there is a posterolateral fractures, and malunion and myositis ossification, which is a calcification in the muscle. Let's discuss briefly the cuberous valgus and the cuberous varus. This is the angle drawn between the longitudinal axis of the humerus and the longitudinal axis of the ulna. If the angle is 30 degrees or more, this is called cubitus valgus. Remember, in cubitus valgus, the elbow is inward and the hand is outward. In cubitus varus, the angle is minus 5 And in Gunstock deformity, the angle is minus 15. And remember that in cubitus varus, the elbow is outward and the hand is inward. This is the recurvatum deformity, and it happens in type 2 and in type 3 fractures if we do not manage them operatively. And it's a hyperextension of the elbow more than 5 degrees. This is the Volkmann ischemic contraction, and it happens if we do the flexion and the casting more than 90 degrees. The second most common elbow fracture is the lateral mass fracture. And it most commonly are Salter-Harris type 4 fracture, which include the epiphysis, the physis, and the metaphysis. The WISC classification is important to determine the type of management. In type 1, there is less than 2 mm and an intact cartilaginous hinge. In type 2, there is more than 2 mm and less than 4 mm displacement with an intact articular cartilage and arthrogram. In type 3, there is more than 4 mm articular surface disturbed on the arthrogram. Type 1 is managed by casting. Type 2 is managed by close reduction and fixation. And type 3 is managed by open reduction and fixation. If we do an x-ray for the lateral mass fracture, we're going to see the fracture fragment lies posteroanteriorly, and we're going to see that the capitulum is laterally displaced in relation to the radial head, as we see here. The complications of lateral mass fractures are more common than the supracondylar fracture. The patients who have lateral mass fractures are more predisposed for stiffness, delayed union and non-union, and cubitus valgus, and avascular necrosis, and fishtail deformity, which is an area between the medial ossification center and the lateral condylar ossification center that fails to develop, lateral overgrowth or spurring, and growth at rest. The last condition we're going to talk about is nurse-made elbow. If you apply a sudden longitudinal traction on the hand, you're going to cause a subluxation of the angular ligament of the child. Usually, we do not need to do an x-ray if the history is clear of a traction injury, if the child is less than 5 years, and if there is a consistent clinical examination, the patient refuses to use the arm that got injured. Most likely, we're going to treat this patient non-operatively with closed reduction, unless there is a chronic symptom and there is inability to do the closed reduction. The last thing we're going to discuss is a specific complication to each type of fractures. In supracondylar humerus fracture, think about cubitus varus and Volkmann ischemic contraction. These are the most common. In femur fracture and mid-diaphyseal radius and ulnar fracture, think about refractures again. In femur fractures, especially if the patient is less than 5 years of age, think of overgrowth. In lateral humeral condylar fracture, think of non-union. In femoral neck fractures, think about talus fractures, which can cause osteonecrosis. In proximal tibial fractures, think about progressive valgus. By this, I conclude this brief lecture. Thank you so much. Stay healthy and good luck.